hell was that? I saw it from the window. I saw something.
Forget about it, Barry. It's just me going crazy.
Oh, jeez. Oh, jeez. You're not crazy. I wish you were crazy, but you're not crazy. Al, be careful.
Stay in the cabin. Don't open the door for anyone. I mean it. In that last instant of consciousness, Rusty thought about Rose. He was older than she was. Rose was barely out of her teens. But she made him feel young and forget what a train wreck his long-dead marriage had been. He still wore the ring. He'd been waiting for her to tell him to take it off. Now she never would. Lover's Peak was at the far end of the nature trail. Nobody in Bright Falls seemed to know where Al was, but Rose, the waitress at the diner, had seen him. From what Barry could tell, Al pretty much fell off the face of the earth when he left the diner. Rose was just the kind of fan that Al hated, but she really tried to help. She was smart, too, knew a lot about what was going on in the town, knew a lot about Al, even knew who Barry was. Barry liked her. That was no big surprise. When it came to women, Barry and Al rarely saw eye to eye. I turn the corner, afraid of what the flashlight's beam might reveal. Suddenly, a roughly painted symbol of a torch glowed in the light. Behind it, hidden by a rock, sat a battered metal trunk. It was here for a reason, packed with supplies, batteries, flares, ammo, things you need to make it through the darkness of the night. Something left behind by someone who knew what I knew, and more.
Thank you.
Agent Nightingale didn't want to be in Bright Falls. These little communities revolted him, and he didn't like the trees or the coffee. He now knew that impossible horrors lurked behind the storefronts and smiles. He desperately wanted to turn the car around and just drive until he passed out or ran out of road and booze. But he had a job to do. He had a rider to catch, at any cost.
We gotta get moving. More of them coming. That flashlight's kid stuff. The flares will keep the bastards away.
You can see them too?
Hell, of course I see them. Come on, we gotta move.
Why?
Because that's the way the story goes.
Yeah, but...
Let's move!
I lost my gun back there.
Oh, I've got a gun. Just keep that light steady on him.
It took a moment, but then I recognized him. He'd been on the ferry when I first arrived here with Alice. He knew my name. We were headed in the direction of Lover's Peak. There was no way this was a coincidence. He was the kidnapper.
Come on, Wake. You better keep up. You set him up, and I'll knock him down, Wake. These stairs, Wake. Use the flares from the emergency box to hold them off while I get these boards off.
Give me the gun.
Yeah, no can do, Wake.
Are you kidding? Give me the gun!
No time for back talk. Hold them off, damn it! Just a little longer. Scare them off! Just a little longer. I almost got it. Okay, it's open. Move it or lose it. Oh, you feeling better now, Wake? All cozy and safe. Better get ready. They'll be on us soon. This is it, Wake. The last stand. There's more flares here. Get ready. We fight them as long as they keep coming.
Give me the goddamn gun! They're coming!
That's not how this goes. Get with the program, Wake. More flares here. Get ready. We fight them as long as they keep coming.
Give me the goddamn gun! They're coming!
That's not how this goes. Get with the program, Wake.
Let's cut the act now. Where's my wife?
I knew you were gonna say that. I read it all before. You're a hell of a writer. Congratulations. You're gonna bring about something glorious and terrible once we get you some proper editorial control.
What the hell are you talking about? Where's Alice?
I want the entire manuscript, or she's gonna suffer bad.
You touch her up.
Thank you.
Arthur, you'll be sorry!
No! Come back here! I swear I'll kill you if you hurt Alice! Do you hear me? Come back here!
He had Alice, and he wanted the manuscript because he thought it held some magical power. But I had no manuscript to give him. I had to get back to Barry and figure out my next move. On more than one occasion, Alice had tried to explain to me how it felt to be afraid of the dark. To her, darkness wasn't simply the absence of light, but something more tangible than that. It was something you could touch and feel. Worse than that, it was something with a mind of its own, something malicious and malign. For her, things changed when they were wrapped in darkness. They turned into something else, something foreign, and nothing was safe or innocent anymore. I'd never really understood what she meant until now. Rusty had warned me about these traps. It hurt like hell. I was stuck. Sarah didn't care about the legal threats Wake's agent had made. She let Wake go without argument, because there was something about him she couldn't quite put her finger on, something that reminded her of her father. She didn't think Wake would hurt his wife. Then she thought about the way he waded into Hartman, that hair-trigger rage flaring up without warning.
Thank you.
The night had been one desperate situation after another. I was exhausted, and my body felt as though it had been chewed up and spat out. The flashlight was heavy in my hand, and each pull of the trigger sent a painful shock up my arm. But I was finally out of the woods, and things were looking up. That's when I heard the chainsaw. I had heard the plane fall. It made no sense. It was clear that it had just fallen in, but it was very old and obviously hadn't flown in decades. Looking at it sent a shiver down my spine. The logging site was a mess. The modular office had been pushed off the cliff. Deputy Thornton climbed up from the wreckage excited, breathing hard from the exertion. Nobody there. It's weird. Don't you think that's weird? Bored, Mulligan let out a mighty snort. Hell, it's always weird, Thornton. Just a question of sorting out what kind of weird it is this time around.